You're watching the free version of Silhouette Essentials. For projects and footage, head to BorisFX.com for the premium download.
Welcome to another Roto Essentials class, this time with most of the focus on hard surface Roto. My name is Katie Morris and I will be your instructor. In this class, there will be much time spent on tracking techniques, Roto methods and tips, and some new features such as reflecting shapes and cryptomat export to Nuke. I have a finished version of my shot here, but we're going to start fresh alongside it. I brought in another copy of my source, and we need to add a Roto node. I'm selected on my source node, and I can press the Tab key, and up comes the search box. I can type in Roto, hit Return, and now my Roto node is hooked up properly to my source node. So let's take a look at the first shot for this class. A man walking inside an office building. While every shot or footage clip is different and unique, there are some categories they fall into in terms of Roto. The main ones are hard surface, soft surface, or otherwise known as organic Roto, and then of course hair Roto. This shot could be categorized as hard surface because the majority of the objects are hard surface or interior objects. And then while we have this walking subject here, that would be considered our soft surface or organic component. There are a lot of things to Roto here, so this shot lends itself well for training purposes, and I will proceed with the Roto as if we need to replace parts of the building structures to remove unwanted reflections for far BG replacement and sky enhancement. The camera is not steady, so tracking won't be as straightforward. And just a note here, the tracking process itself will be sped up in the post-recording process to save time. I'm going to start with the floor and this office building window structure. I could make an ROI to save memory, but the full-size clip is cached in and it looks like I will be okay here. If you noticed earlier, I disabled the source node in my other tree. I did that so Silhouette would not cache both source nodes in. Down in the lower right corner, you can ascertain your memory usage, down here in this lower bar. Here you can see I've only used up a small portion of my memory, that's 13%. If you notice this number getting really high, you can purge the cache by either double-clicking this bar, like this, and now it's down to 1%, or 2%, or you can go up to the session menu here and click Purge RAM Cache. And if you wonder why this number down here in the lower right always goes to 10, it's because that is predetermined by preferences. If I open up the preferences and go to the cache preferences, we're already there, you can see that my preload frames number is 10. So each time you click on a source, it will load in 10 frames. So we'll cache the shot through once again. So for hard surface Roto shots, my shot approach always includes incorporating as much tracking assist as possible. With this floor here, I want to use a planar tracker. So I'm just going to stop the playback here. You can see that there's some rocking in the floor, and I'm trying to determine how I'm going to make my shape. But first, I have to make sure I have my Roto node selected, and then change the view mode to foreground for faster tracking. I'm going to open up the tracker tab, click on the tracking icon here, and you can see we're in the Mocha tracker tab already. So now I'm going to determine where I need to make my shape and want to capture all the rocking movement. So I probably want to make it on the side here, but I realize that I probably need to make another shape over here as well to capture the movement on the screen right side of the floor. So what I can do is make two shapes. I'll make one shape here, and I'll make another shape on the other side. And we'll just move that up a little bit there to capture that area, and maybe move it away from the shadow. And then I can select both of these shapes in the object list, and we can track like that. So I'm going to go back to the tracker tab here, and I'm going to make sure that we're clicked on translation, scale, and rotation because I want all of that. and we will track forwards. And like I said, if I just tracked a section over here, I wouldn't capture this movement over here. And if I made one big shape across the floor, it would either take way too much time to track, or it would get confused by the subject walking through it. And you can also see here that when I started the tracking process, that a layer was automatically made. Okay, let's see how that worked out. I'm going to turn off my tracker shapes and I'm going to drop in a shape. I'm just going to make a square shape real quick to see if this worked. Okay, so that looks really good. And we just have one keyframe. I can go in here and just refine my shape a little bit. Actually, what I want to do is go to the frame where I made my shape. And then maybe drag it out to encompass the whole floor. And then as usual practice, I'll go in here and I will make my trackers green and name them TRK and lock them. I'm going to label my layer floor and I'm just going to pull out my shape a little bit more. I'm not as concerned about the separation here between the wall and the floor. We're just looking to make a large enough holdout mat to separate this interior from the background. Okay, next we're going to tackle some of these vertical beams.